Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Trojan Broadcast Network for tonight's first round TVL girls basketball matchup between the Upper Dolphin Trojans and the Millersburg Indians. My name is Connor Dietrich. Tonight I am joined by the esteemed Mr. Todd Rupp from my broadcasting partner. Welcome to the broadcast, Mr. Rupp.
Thanks for joining us, buddy. Good to have you back
absolutely.
Here.
Absolutely. It's good to be here.
Good to have you back. We got to mention we have Jordan Pfeiffer running the truck and computer for us this evening. We appreciate
Thank
him.
Thank you, Jordan.
One of my top fellas. So.
So looking at some records and some statistics here for this game, overall records, these teams are actually the same, 17-5. Upper Dolphin did finish 11-2 in the league versus 9-4 for Millersburg, so that's why Upper Dolphin is the home team tonight. Looking at the actual statistics, though, it's pretty dead even between these teams. Looking at scoring offense, both these teams average 49 points a game, so really close there in offense. Defense, slight advantage to Upper Dolphin, 33 points allowed per game versus 36 for Millersburg. And, we should point out Upper Dolphin did win both matchups in the regular season, the first of which by 6 points, the second of which by 16. So a little bit closer the first time around.
Yeah. And the one thing, the Trojans always seem to be near the top defensively as far as scoring goes. Coach Huffman always has his girls playing some tough defense. But the difference, I think, in that second game to now is the absence probably, you don't like to label number one, number two, but probably Millersburg's second best player.
I would say
Reagan Hale.
She broke her foot, I believe. So, yeah, she was playing for that first matchup when it was a very close game right down to the end. That second game at Millersburg, it was close till halftime, and then Millersburg really doesn't have any depth, so they just kind of got tired and worn out as the game went on, but they kept it close for the first half.
Yeah, the rumor is that the Hale girl could be back, possibly.
Oh, really?
It wasn't a break, I guess.
Okay, yeah.
And must be doing some pretty heavy physical therapy.
Definitely
and
no fracture.
She could be potentially back for district playoffs.
That's good. That's good for them. And, I mean, speaking of districts, Millersburg, they are the number one seed in, I guess, is that single A?
Double A.
And then Upper Dolphin is the sixth seed in Triple A. So they will go travel to Pequot Valley for their first game. And Millersburg will have a home game in their first match.
Yeah, Millersburg, Double A takes the top four.
Okay.
So Millersburg will be in the semis. Trojans at district Triple A takes the top six, so they were the last team to kind of sneak in. And
they were actually out of it before they beat Millersburg last week. That win propelled them into the districts.
It was insane when you looked at that District 3 standing.
Very close.
I mean, there was the one Brandywine Heights is a seventh, and they're not going to get in, and they're 14-6 on the season, which
that's tough.
That's crazy. That's the way it goes. But then you look at Double A, and you got three teams that are going to be in that are less than 500.
Under 500, yeah. Millersburg, I'd say, just looking at records, has to be the favorite there to take the Double A title. But crazier things have definitely happened.
I would say so, too. Even without Hale, 17-5 in that Double A, and they're the defending Double A champs.
Right, yes, they are.
So, they, Lancaster Menlight probably is a team that they should not sleep on.
Oh, definitely not.
They play in a tough, tough league down there. And without looking, I can almost guarantee I can name some Lancaster men. Losses are probably two to Columbia, two to Lancaster Catholic, and two to Pequot Valley.
Yeah, those teams that have a bad record but play really good teams, it's hard to get a judge on them just by their record.
Right.
For sure. Looking at some individual statistics for tonight's game, we have a couple of league leaders in various stats here tonight. Jaina Strait, she is the leading scorer of the players in this game. She averaged 14.5 points per game this year, good for fourth in the league. Gracie Griffiths not far behind at 13 points per game, good for sixth in the league. We also have Emma Miller for Millersburg and Reagan Hale, who's not playing for Millersburg, on the league leaders as well. Looking at rebounds, I mean, Emma Miller far and away leads the league in rebounds. She actually crossed 1,000 rebounds for her career as a junior, which that's a lot of rebounds. Most girls don't do that in 4, 5, 6 years if you gave them 6 years, and she did it in 3.
But the Trojans have 3 on that list.
Right, yeah, that's what.
You know, when you got Wibley with 102, Wenzel with 91, and Griffiths with 88. So they're going to have to do it more as a, where Millersburg relies on Miller.
To hold down the whole entire paint.
Yep,
right.
The Trojans can kind of spread the ball around there as far as getting rebounds. And Reagan Wenzel's one that I don't think gets enough credit
Team MVP to me. I mean, she might not have the highest stats, but she does everything on the court for them. She's a really good player.
A lot of the dirty work.
Absolutely. I mean, and talking about the big girls for Upper Dolphin, the game at Millersburg last week, I believe Wibley led the way with 15 points, or else Reagan Wenzel. One of them had 14, and Griffiths had 13. So all three big girls, they're going to contribute every night, no
doubt.
Right.
And that's the one thing when you watch Millersburg. Now, granted, I'm just a wrestling coach.
Just the wrestling guy.
But I look at Millersburg, and they got some big girls.
Yeah, right, they
and,
do.
You know, the fact that they don't dominate in the inside a little bit, like a little, maybe I'm just a little old school when it comes to that, but you would think that they could dominate there on the inside, especially when you look at the, you know, start talking double A playoffs,
right?
That's an area right. that they could expose teams on. But
I think with Upper Dauphin, their big girls probably have the athleticism edge a little bit. And not that Notre's big girls aren't athletic. It's just, you know, Wibley, Griffiths, Wenzel, they're very good athletes, no mm-hmm. doubt. So they make some up the size disadvantage there. But, I mean, overall, I think, speaking of Wibley, I think it's fair to call her the X factor for this game. I think she had a very good game against Millersburg last week. I remember last year in the league championship over at Newport, she had a very big game as well. She just seems to play well against Millersburg.
Yep.
And, again, Griffiths gets so much attention. Wenzel will get more attention than usual because she had a great game against them last time. So there will be openings for Wibley if she can just take advantage of them.
Yeah, it will be interesting to see what they do with Wenzel, as she definitely was a difference maker in that game.
Yeah, so she covered Janus
Strait. Just last Friday, right?
Yeah, so she covered Janus Strait after Gracie Griffiths got in foul trouble. But I did talk to Coach Zigner for Upper Dauphin, and he said that Griffiths will be back on Janus Strait to start the game. They are going to change some things defensively, but that will be the matchup.
And so. I would think Strait will probably be on Griffiths
as
well.
They both guard each other very well.
And they know each other well. They play soccer together.
It's funny. These girls are bitter enemies on the court, but a lot of them are friends off the court just from playing soccer together, playing softball together, track, all kinds of things.
Yep, a few weeks they'll be on the same team.
Yeah,
on the softball field. Guided by Millersburg head coach
Chad Everhart.
Right.
It all comes full circle.
So, it's a lot of familiarity between the two teams, and looks like the student section did not get the memo of the winter storm advisory coming in as they the Hawaiian theme tonight.
They're ready to break out the surfboards and the swimming shorts.
Yeah,
tonight.
Kind of interesting. Maybe a little snow surfing tomorrow.
Right. Yeah.
We'll see.
Potentially a lot of it. Looking at an X factor on the Millersburg side, I think me and Mr. Up both agree it is definitely Olivia Dyer. She's not going to stuff the stat sheet for them, but she plays very good defense. She handles the ball well. She didn't start last game because of senior night. Somebody started over her, mm-hmm. and as soon as she came in, the game just turned. She just is a very good player for them.
And that's the one thing I've gotten to watch her over the last couple of years with my daughter Kara playing, and she doesn't look intimidating or something that you have to really as a big threat.
Right.
But boy, does she. She does a lot of, like we talked about Reagan doing some of the dirty work. She does a
Absolutely.
Lot of dirty work as well. She is a hustler. She distributes the ball very well as well. So be anxious to see how that goes this evening. But should be a good one. Got about minute 46 here left as Coach Huffman's over there. He's got his khakis and sneakers. He's looking pretty dapper.
Got to
go with the black polo tonight. Digging it.
Simple and classic right there.
Yep,
it looks like we're going to step away for a little bit here. We're going to get the starting lineups, then the national anthem, and then we will be back for tip-off.
Good evening and welcome to Upper Dauphin Area High School for tonight's Tri-Valley League semifinal contest between the Indians of Millersburg and your Upper Dauphin Area Lady Trojans. As a reminder to all spectators, this facility and all district property is a non-smoking, non-tobacco, and non-alcohol use environment. The district also has a spectator conduct policy that is posted in the hallway. Failure to abide by any of these policies may lead to your dismissal from this event. In an effort to keep our facility clean, please place your trash in the containers that are provided. As a reminder, food and drink may not be brought into the gymnasium by spectators. The school district also asks that you refrain from parking cars on cemetery grounds. And now for our starting lineups. First, for the Millersburg Lady Indians. Guard, senior number 4, Janice Strait. Guard, junior number 12, Olivia Dyer. Forward, number 20, senior Lauren Rockmore. Guard, senior number 23, Fallon McFadden. And center, number 35, junior Emma Miller. And now for your Lady Trojans, number 22, senior Emily Dyer. Junior, number 21, Maisie Bingaman. Junior, number 12, Casey Wildman. Sophomore, number 34, Reagan Wenzel. And senior, number 11, Gracie Griffin. Now would you all please rise, and gentlemen, remove your caps for the singing of our national anthem by UDA Junior Cameron Smelts.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so
all right, here we go. Ready for tip-off. And Mr. Ruff was right, by the way. Reagan Hale not in a boot over there, so you might be right. Yeah, that might not be a fraction.
I hear things at school. I mean, I hear some stuff here and
you're
there.
You're plugged in.
Yeah, I get a little plugged in there. But how about all the Cowans coming out of the woodwork today? You got Mike and Dale and Ethan all here.
Like, Ethan, right. Yeah, third Cowan.
Throw him in there.
I don't know if we can hold him to the status of the other two.
Maybe not.
We can throw him in.
Yeah.
All right, we got Wibley and Miller here for the tip-off. And here we go. Miller wins the tip to Dyer. Looks like Upper Dolphin is man-to-man, I believe, up there. Man-to-man defense for now. Millersburg's pass is a little erratic already, but Dyer does corral it. She gets it stripped by Dyer, and we have Wenzel going the other way for a breakaway. Wenzel finishes the layup, and we have a 2-0 Trojans lead early on. That man-to-man defense by the Trojans has given Millersburg problems previously. Good screen by Miller there on Griffiths, and I thought Wenzel had a clean block there on Strait, but they're going to give her the foul.
I got to say, I kind of agree with you there. I thought that was a nice play by Wenzel, but credit Strait.
Yep.
Finding a little lane there, driving to the basket, and getting herself to the free throw line.
That pick and roll with Miller and Strait, that will be a common theme tonight for Millersburg, I'm sure. Get their two best players going to the basket, working together. Strait, she doesn't miss free throws too often. She's among the league leaders, I believe I saw.
Yes. I can get that for you here in a minute, buddy.
Yep, she is up there, the ninth, I believe, in the league. So,
yep.
Good free throw shooter.
And she Makes them both.
Knocks them both in. You know, even without Harrell, I would definitely still call Millersburg a good team. And the old adage is it's hard to beat a good team three times in one season. So I think we're in for a dogfight tonight.
Yeah, that is something that you see happen a lot. It is very tough to beat a good team three times.
Good aggression there by Olivia Dyer. Ties up Reagan Wenzel, forces the jump ball. That's the kind of thing that we were talking about. She will be doing that all night.
There we have two of the big players that we felt are the unsung heroes kind of going at it there.
Yep, that's exactly right. Bingaman's going to inbound it to Wenzel. She's going to maybe shoot a deep three. She passes it up, though. She drives around. Miller dishes to Wibley, but again, Dyer with the help defense gets in there and forces the turnover. Dyer already showing what she brings to the team tonight, handling the ball and playing good defense. Emily Dobbert with some good defense, almost gets the steal. Millersburg being patient here. Dyer rips and goes baseline, and Dibert knocks it out of bounds, so it will be Millersburg's ball under the basket here. We'll see what Millersburg does here. Usually you see, they're doing kind of a stack play. Yeah. Going to look to Miller, I'm sure. Oh, actually, Rotham, a great play, but a nice block by Reagan Wenzel. That was a really good play by Millersburg, but Wenzel made up for it. She finds Bingaman on the fast break. Bingaman's going to kick to Dibert. And Upper Dolphin probably going to settle down here. And, oh, never mind. Maisie Bingaman takes it. She's up and she's off the glass and good. Running layup from Maisie Bingaman makes it a 4-2 Trojans lead.
All right, we're forking out some technical difficulty, but we're good now. Didn't catch you. Made that last bucket for the Trojans.
Maisie Bingaman, nice layup she made. Dibert getting pretty handsy there on Olivia Dyer. Might see some reaches here on Dibert at some point, but they have not called it yet, so maybe they're going to let him play tonight. Straight looking inbound for the Indians. She's going to get it to McFadden. Yep, McFadden was looking for straight but traveled with it before she got the pass off, so going back the other way for the Trojans.
A lot of turnovers to get things started here, Con.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, there's, again, these two chippy teams, they're going to be playing tough defense. A low-scoring game would not surprise me, be pointed out. Two very good defensive teams. Dibert gets the ball, and Bingaman knocks it over to Wenzel for the long two. She misses. Rebound by Lauren Rothamel. Millersburg looked to run transition, but now they're going to slow it down.
Yeah, Miller looked like she wanted to push the pace there a little.
Yeah, I thought they were trying to. It looks like we're going to have a reach-in foul on Griffiths. Millersburg trying to get the ball to straight. Griffiths tried to deny the pass, but she committed the foul. Millersburg probably going to run a screen play here for straight to the corner. And they do. Straight's going to rip it inside. And Wenzel's going to tie her up. And we have our second jump ball of the evening. 2 minutes into the game, we have two jump balls already.
Wenzel involved in both of them.
Both of them, yep. Sure she'll be involved in more throughout the night.
But those are the little things we talked about before the game that she does. It just aren't on the stat sheet.
Right. That was a nice rip and go there by Emma Miller. She got around Casey Wibley and finished through some contact. There maybe could have been a foul there, but no foul called, and we are all tied up at four.
As long as they continue to call the game that way throughout the game,
right.
Connor, I'm fine
with
that.
Oh, absolutely.
Let them play, fine.
But Wibley.
Don't change midway through.
Right, exactly. Wibley almost had a little skyhook shot to fall there, but it did just rim out. Straight's going to pull up for three. It looks short from here, and it is off the front rim, but Miller corrals the rebound and can't finish the putback. Good job by Wibley, but she's tied up by Fallon McFadden. We have our third jump ball of the evening, and it will be Trojans' ball. That's not a shot the Trojans want to see Straight putting up because she will knock those down more often than not.
No, especially if she gets in a rhythm.
Yes, she got in a rhythm down at Millersburg last week, and I think she had 19 points that game, so she's a very good shooter.
Coach Huffman just asked for a good high-low, Connor.
Well, we got a good look here for Griffiths. A nice left-handed layup. Well, right-handed layup from the left side, but either way, it works. Good rip and go there from Griffiths. Jana Straight gambled to steal the pass, and she didn't get it. And the rest was history. 6-4 Trojans. Here we got this pick and roll again with Straight and Miller. Straight denies the screening, throws for a skip pass for Rothamon again. There's Wenzel with those active hands. That pass never had a chance.
Trojan defense playing very well thus far here in the first quarter.
Dibert's going to shoot three. That looks long, but Wenzel has the rebound. Dibert had a layup, passed it up to Wibley, and Wibley turns it over, looking for Bingaman. That got a little flustered there. Foul McFadden's coming the other way. She hits Dyer. Dyer looks for a three. Might be banked. No, but short. And we have Gracie Griffiths going the other way for the Trojans. She has Bingaman. Bingaman has a shot, but she's going to dribble in. Dump to Wibley for the little bunny hop. Easy shot. That's what I'm saying all night long. If the Trojans guards can get past their matchups, they're going to have those dump offs to Wibley and Wenzel all night long.
Nice job there by the Trojans. Now a 4-point lead, 4 minutes to go here in the first quarter.
Dyer has the ball in the corner from Millersburg. She was looking for Rothermel. She's going to drive to the basket instead. It's going to be knocked away by Dybert again. Millersburg ball underneath.
Again, Connor, I'm going to say, Miller in there, big tall girl.
Yeah.
Just the fact that they don't try to get it into her much.
Yeah, and like every possession, ideally.
Yeah.
She should always touch it. She's not always going to shoot it, but she can pass out. Nice pass there from straight to Rothermel. Wenzel comes from behind and
another
with a nice
jump
block
ball.
With a jump ball. That was a good block by Wenzel. Fortunately, it results with Rothermel on the ground, so we're going to, of course, hope she's okay.
Holding her lower back a little
bit.
Yeah,
it must have probably just took a hard fall.
And it looks like she's going to be okay. Bounce up.
I mean, of course, we hope she's okay just for her sake, and also Millersburg, they're hoping she's okay because they don't really have much coming off the bench. They're going to play these five girls as long as they possibly can tonight.
We talked about that before the game.
Yeah.
The Trojans definitely have a deeper bench.
Yeah, they only really play seven girls, but compared to five, that's a huge difference. I mean, five girls will tire out way faster than seven girls will tire out. Dybert's looking for Bigman over on the wing. Bigman has Griffiths on the cut. Griffiths looks inside, out to Wibley. Bigman able to corral it, and Wenzel is going to rip and go and get fouled by Dyer on the shot. So Wenzel will have two free throws. Are they going to call it underneath? Oh, wow.
No shot? Wow.
That's surprising. I thought for sure she was in the shooting motion there, but it will be Trojan's ball underneath.
Still on Dyer, though. That's a first foul against, actually, a second foul against the Indians.
Wenzel might shoot this three. She doesn't mind shooting from out there, and she's going to knock it down. I don't know why teams don't ever cover her outside the three-point line. We have a 30-second timeout for Millersburg, so we're not going to go to commercial here for a 30-second break. But, I mean, I've seen Wenzel do it so many times this year. She gets the ball out beyond the three-point line, and they don't cover her.
And the last few weeks, Connor, really seems like she's getting a lot more confident with her shot.
Sure. Absolutely.
And nothing more dangerous than a confident person.
Right, absolutely. I mean, that's what sometimes you would see previously she would hesitate.
Yes.
She thought about it. There she didn't think. She just shot it. And that's a big improvement from last year. She was already good as a freshman last year, but a lot of her scoring was in the paint. This year she's done a lot more scoring on the jump shot, and it's really helped her game a lot.
Yeah, she's definitely looking good. And Trojans out to a nice little lead here to start things off, 7-point lead.
Yeah, Millersburg's got they really haven't had many good possessions. They're kind of all over the place. They're a little miscombobulated. We'll see if they can get a good look here. McFadden's going to look to go with the right hand. She passes off to Dyer. Again, Millersburg's just clustered. They're all in the same half of the court. Not very good spacing. Nice move from straight, though, to get Griffiths up on her feet, but she can't finish the layup. So we have Griffiths going the other way. She's going to go back to Dybert. Chargers will slow it down and run through their offense. Don't need to force anything. Dybert finds Wibley at the high post. She's going to kick it over to Wenzel. She might shoot. Nope, she's going to go for the layup. Hard off the glass. Yet another jump ball involving Reagan Wenzel. And we are going the opposite way.
The Trojans don't get possession, but Wenzel just hustles every minute on the court there.
You'll take any jump ball. Dyer looked like she got around Bigman. Bigman must have knocked it loose, though,
double
and Dyer
dribble.
Double dribbled. I think she thought the ball was knocked loose, but I think it was a double dribble. Again, just not many good possessions so far for Millersburg. They just have been out of sorts, not their usual selves.
Offensively, Trojans seem to be moving the ball much better.
Yeah, they're getting good looks. They're not really forcing anything. Wibley going to pass off to Griffiths, who's going to kick to Wenzel on the wing. She'll shoot another three. That one's off, but Bingaman gets the rebound, and she's blocked, so it will stay Trojans' ball underneath. I think it might have been Rothermel that got a hand on that one.
Mm-hmm. There's some tall girls down there. Bingaman's not exactly a giant.
Ball looked to get into Griffiths, but Miller knocked it loose and straight did corral it. Good defense there by Miller. Indians now looking to finally stop the bleeding here a little bit. But again, the help defense from the Trojans. Reagan Wenzel gets her hand on it. Dybert's going the other way. She couldn't quite finish through the contact.
Another jump ball.
We have a pretty quick whistle on the jump ball there.
I would have to agree. Looked like
It looked like McFadden came away with it pretty quickly.
It was definitely a little quicker on the jump ball that time.
Trojans will take it, though. They retain possession. Bingaman's the inbounder. She's going to get it into Wibley at the top of the key. Do a little dump off to Dibert over in the corner. Dibert's going to go to the left hand down there on the baseline, and she stepped in the line. It's just ran out of space down there.
The 144 here left in the first quarter. Indians desperately need to get something going offensively here.
I mean, they're not even getting shot attempts. They're turning the ball over way too often. Up and often in some kind of a zone here. Maybe like a 1-3-1, some kind of a triangle zone. Looking to trap the ball handler. Dyer thought about a three. She passes it up, and Wenzel almost comes away with a steal. And the Trojans will still get a turnover out of it. Straight had Miller, but I think just Wenzel with a swarming defense didn't even give her a passing lane.
Straight pleading their case there that the ball was tipped.
I didn't think so. That ball had too much speed on it to have been tipped, I think.
Yeah, it didn't change direction.
Millersburg going to run some kind of a zone press of their own here. Bingaman has Wibley in the middle. She has Gracie on the backside. Griffiths doesn't quite get it because Dyer gets a hand on it, but it will remain Trojans' ball.
Indians maybe going with a press, trying to get a little momentum, get some energy. They don't look very energized right now offensively.
If they can get a steal and an easy layup, just something to get something in the basket. They haven't scored in a while now. They just need to get an easy shot. The inbound goes off the rails a little bit, but Griffiths corrals it in the backcourt. She's going to bring it up the court. Trying to get around straight, but straight playing good defense. Gracie eventually gets around her and can't quite finish the layup, but Wibley rebounds it. She can't finish. She tries again. And she gets it to fall. That's how it goes sometimes. Takes a couple shots, but eventually you get it up and in. And Upward Offense now out to a 13-4 lead. We have Dyer going up for the layup. She misses. Miller gets a rebound, but Wibley got a handle on it as well. Gracie Griffiths thought about a shot. She's going to kick to Bingaman, who's going to look to shoot a three. She's usually knocked down from out there, and she is. AC Bingaman makes it a 16-4 lead for the Trojans.
Trojans looking tough here in the first quarter. Yeah. And all year they have gotten off to great starts in the first quarter.
Yeah.
So nothing that surprises the Trojan fans.
Yeah, if they can maintain this in the second quarter, then we're talking. Rothamel's going to crowd a loose ball. Straight now has it. Going to look inside to Miller. But help defense again from Diver. The Trojans' help defense has been incredible all night long. They have been active hands in the passing lanes. It's been great. Dibert is going to turn it over. They're looking for Wenzel with 0.4 seconds left. So barring something crazy, we're going to go into the second quarter with a 16-4 Trojans lead. And that is the case. So we are going to run some commercials here, and we'll be back soon. It is a 16-4 Trojans lead here on the Trojan Sports Network.
Best tasting pizza in the valley, come visit JoJo's Pasta and Pizza House. We have something here for everyone, such as
garlic knots, seafood, desserts, and gluten-free options.
We are back here in the Trojan Sports Network. I was just telling Mr. Up, it's been a while since I've done one of these. I forgot how much talking goes into these games. Dealing with a little bit of a dry mouth here, but I'll get used to it. It's like riding a bike. You never forget.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes. But we appreciate you stepping in tonight.
Absolutely. Always ready for this. Still no subs for either. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Jordan Miller does check in for the Trojans. She replaces, it looks like, Maisie Bingaman went out.
She's another three-point threat for Upper Dauphin.
I would say Jordan Miller, good three-point shooter and good active hands on defense. Straight again going to miss. She's just not on yet tonight. But Miller corrals the rebound and Wibley gets a block. And then we should have a foul here on Dyer. I think Dyer committed the reach and then came away eating a little bit of an elbow, but it is the foul on her. That's her second. So, again, with Millersburg really not using any substitutes, anybody in remote foul trouble is not a good sign for them.
No, and the Indians really struggling underneath the basket,
yeah.
Connor.
Yeah, I mean, Miller, she can't quite finish some of her shots, but also the help defense has been great. Upper Dolphins getting a hand on everything. All of her shot attempts, the pass attempts, their defense has been incredible. Miller's going to look to find Griffiths here. She's going to dribble left, spin back right, and find Miller in the corner. Miller drives baseline, dishes to Wildly, out to Wenzel for the long two. Just long. I thought that might have went off of McFadden, but it's going to be out on Miller, so it will be Millersburg ball. Dyer's going to bring it up here for the Indians. Upper Dolphin back to their regular man-to-man defense by the looks of it, and Bingaman is checking back in here soon. Miller can't control that pass. I mean, it's just, oh, Chad Everhart over there. I know he's frustrated. There's been just turnover after turnover.
Not doing a very good job of taking care of the ball or the Indians.
No, I mean, they're not even getting shot attempts up.
No.
Diver's going to get it into Miller, who kicks it to Wibley for the two-point attempt, and it's good. I'm telling you, Casey Wibley always seems to save her best performances for these games with Millersburg. 18-4, Trojans lead, and they, Millersburg will send their first sub to the line. I'm going to assume for Rothermel. McFadden has it. She looks inside to Rothermel, and Wenzel knocks it away. I think Rothermel's still dealing with the effects from that fall she took earlier. Yeah, she's kind of limping a little bit, so she's going to come out.
So that's Valier that'll check in, right?
Yep. Valier, that's almost certainly the only other player we'll see for the Indians tonight, barring something unforeseen.
You mentioned Wibley. She leads all scorers with 6 points thus far.
Yeah, Wibley, I mean, she's another one like Wenzel. You would think she only really scores from in the paint, but she can shoot a jump shot, too, and she showed it off there. We have a 30-second timeout, so we're going to stay here. I just know Coach Everhart over there, he's got to be ripping his hair out right now. The passes aren't there. They have open looks, and they just can't control a pass, or it gets tipped away.
They just look really out of sync.
It's just, I mean, again, we give credit to the Upper Dolphin defense. It's been among the best in the league all season long, and it's certainly on display tonight.
14-point lead here. We're going to see if we can get us some scores from around the other games. As we mentioned, this is a 2-3 seed. The Trojans were the 2 seed. St. Joe's Catholic is the 1 seed. They are playing Susquehanna tonight.
Yeah, and that's one that St. Joe's was undefeated during the year, but Susquehanna played them very tough, so that's probably going to be a closer game than some might expect. McFadden's going to go for the right-handed layup. It's going to be blocked by Wenzel. Trojans looking to run fast break here. Dibert has it. She kicks to Wenzel. Wenzel finds Bingaman. Bingaman travels with it. I think she should have shot it. When she gets her feet set and she's spotted up, she knocks it down.
St. Joe's is a team. I talk to different ADs around the league, obviously, all the time. And Susquehanna felt that they had the team that it's going to take a team that's going to run
right.
To beat St.
Absolutely
Joe's.
Agree. And strong guard play. And they have good guards.
Yes.
McFadden gets by Miller there. She finishes the layup. Finally, Millersburg breaks their long scoring drought. Makes it 18-6. Yeah, one of the Upper Dolphin coaches told me as well that they think Susquehanna has the team build to potentially give St. Joe some trouble. So we'll see there. Miller's going to look to shoot a three. It's up, and it's off the front rim, but it's going to be rebounded by Dibert. She's going to take a little floater, and she's going to knock it down. Dibert, we saw down at Millersburg. Now, she was playing sick that game, I heard, but she can be hit or miss sometimes. So far tonight, she's playing great. That's a good sign for the Trojans.
Absolutely. Lead extends back to 14.
McFadden for the long two. That's off. Straight had it. Lost it. Got it back to McFadden, and she misses the putback. Miller can't get it to go either. Millersburg just, there's like a lid on the basket for them right now. They can't get anything to fall. Miller's going to look up court to Wenzel. Wenzel manages to save it somehow. Heck of a save by Regan Wenzel. Dibert to Bingaman. Bingaman for three, and she's good. And Coach Everhart's going to take a full timeout here. He's frustrated, so we have a 60-second break. We're going to run some commercials, and we will be right back on the Trojan Broadcast Network.
Dibble, Straub, and Troutman Incorporated is a local insurance company that was founded in 1986 when three separate local insurance companies decided to join forces and become what is now known as Dibble, Straub, and Troutman. Being a partner in the Keystone Insurers Group aids them in their goal to provide its clients with a large array of quality choices within the insurance market. Still have questions? You can ask any of the local companies that are insured by Dibble, Straub, and Troutman, such as Cuppy's Propane, Dairy Queen, or Halifax Area School District. Head over to their main office, which is located right across the street from Cuppy's on the Square in Elizabethville, or go online to www.dstinsurance.com.
And we are back again. It is a 23-6 lead here for the Trojans. Bingaman just knocked down, I believe, her second three of the night. Like I said, when she spotted up and she has her spot, she rarely misses.
Bingaman now 8 points on the evening. And that whole play was set up by the hustle of?
Regan Wenzel.
Yes.
Dyer gets it inside to Miller. There we go. That's what Millersburg should be doing all night long. Get it inside and let Miller put it up. She gets it to go there, and they cut the lead to 15, but they have some digging to do to get out of this hole for sure. Diver's going to get it inside to Wibley. Wibley finds Miller in the corner. She goes inside to Griffiths. Griffiths tried to find Bingaman, but good active hands there. It might have been Miller who knocked that one away. Dyer now coming the other way. She finds McFadden, who has Valier on the wing if she wants her. She does find her. Back to McFadden. McFadden's going to go for the layup and maybe gets gifted one there, but regardless, she's going to go to the free throw line to shoot two.
That was on Griffiths. That'll be her
second. I think it's Bingaman.
Was it Bingaman?
Yes, it was Bingaman. It's up on the scoreboard.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought that was fine defense, but we'll see. Yeah, they say the ball doesn't lie, so maybe it wasn't a foul. Regardless, we're going to have Wenzel checking back in here for Miller and Rothamel for Millersburg back in for Valier. That's, again, what I expect to see. We'll see Valier in some short stints tonight just to get the starters a break. McFadden's second free throw is also off, so we can definitely say the ball doesn't lie. However, the rebound, again, we have a quick whistle on a jump ball. That's the second one of the evening. Trojans will retain possession, though, on the jump ball.
So here we go. Trojans really looking, can put some distance here.
Yes.
Put the pressure on as you didn't mention St. Joe's was undefeated. They did lose their first game of the year to number three-ranked Williamsburg. That
okay.
was Saturday night.
Bingaman for three is good again for the Trojans. She's up to 11 points on the evening. She's on fire. Trojans extend their lead to 18. Yes, I should have said St. Joe's was undefeated in the league, but they had a couple of close games, so they're definitely not unbeatable. Wibley might have got away with one on Miller there, but no foul was called. Rothermel's looking to take it in and dish it to Dyer, but she's going to lose it out of bounds. That she never had a chance. That pass went through her legs. Again, I think
I don't have stats for turnovers tonight, but it's very one side.
I was just going to say, I think there have been more Millersburg possessions ending in a turnover than a shot attempt. They just haven't really been getting shots off. Definitely credit to the Trojans defense for a lot of that.
And credit to Trojans as the second quarter has been kind of a thorn in their
tough
side throughout
year.
The season.
Right,
but
absolutely.
Tonight, not the case.
Bingaman's going to look to get around McFadden, but good defense by McFadden on the baseline, but did go off of her foot. So it will stay Trojans ball. We have Valier checking back in again for Rothermel.
I think Rothermel is definitely bothered, maybe
yeah,
her lower back.
I think so. She hit the floor pretty hard earlier. Wenzel has Griffiths inside. Griffiths going to look to go to the right. Kicks it to Dybert. She finds Wenzel. Good ball movement. Wenzel takes it right around Miller and up for the left-hander layup. That is, again, speaking of that athleticism earlier, Wenzel's undersized in that matchup, but she's so quick.
May have rolled her ankle
there. And now, unfortunately,
there.
She's down, and that is not good.
She's pretty tough, though. I'd be willing to bet she's going to get up, walk it off. You know, if only her brothers were as tough as her, I'd be all right.
I'd say with Wenzel, as long as nothing's broken, she'll be up and ready to go. They're going to take her out, though, but I'm sure she won't be out for long.
I say that knowing that her older brother, Peyton, is definitely at Stevens Tech watching the game right now. So
you'll get a text here soon. Straight going to bring it up for Millersburg. She gets to Valier in the wing. Valier's going to put up a shot, and she almost had it. Dyer with a nice rebound, but she gets blocked by Wibley. That's one where Dyer's just so much shorter. What can she do? Never had a chance. There was a good rebound by her and a good take, but it just never had a chance. Dybert's going to pull a three. That's just off. Dyer will secure the rebound for Millersburg, and we might have a charge. Yeah. That's really tough for Straight there, but it is the right call. Dybert snuck up on her. Straight turned around and smacked right into her. I don't know. The crowd doesn't seem happy with that one. I think it was the right call.
Yeah, Millersburg fans not too happy. I mean, I think it could have went either way.
It's tough for Straight, too, because she never saw it. She turns around and runs into somebody.
Kind of a bam-bam play there.
It was a smart play by Dybert for sure. Dybert's going to dump it off to Wibley here inside. Back out to Dybert. Dybert puts up the three off the back rim, but rebounded by Maisie Bingaman. Griffiths now looking to drive with the right hand. She kicks to Miller in the corner. Miller's three is up, and it's long. Wibley pokes the rebound away from Miller. Good job by the Trojans with their active hand. Griffiths, she goes in for the layup. She gets fouled, and she finishes the shot.
Trojans are firing on all cylinders tonight.
That was a great take there by Gracie Griffith. She hit the little Euro step. She got whacked by, I thought it was Miller. I might have called the foul on straight. Oh, no, it was on Miller. Griffith's looking for the three-point play.
The thing of it is, Connor, that Miller did have position there for the rebound,
yeah,
but Wibley fought,
Same
through.
Thing there.
Yep, again.
Same exact thing. Miller touches it first, and Wibley pokes it away. Great, great job by Casey Wibley. She always has these games against Millersburg. I keep saying it because it's true. Straight gets around Griffiths for a layup there, but Straight not able to find it. Griffiths now going to travel with it. Yeah, she got a little flustered. All good, though. No harm done. You're up by 24 points. No reason to get frustrated. Just keep playing good ball. But yeah, you're absolutely right. Miller, a couple times, she should have had rebounds that she didn't get. Wibley doing a great job against her tonight. Millersburg going to inbound to Dyer. Dyer's going to look to set the offense, but Dybert's giving her no room to breathe. Might have an illegal screen there. That does not go quite. That was probably fine. It was close. Dyer gets it into Miller. She's going to look to give it back to Dyer. Dyer's going to rip and go baseline, and she's fouled by Miller. Miller commits the blocking foul on the baseline, so it will be Indians ball underneath. You can just tell Millersburg, like, they really haven't been able to run an offense many times. They're constantly out of whack.
100%. I mean, it's just, and the Trojan defense.
Swarming.
And they've been switching it up a little bit, it seems like.
Yeah, they have. And it's working. Dyer's three was long, and nobody's got the rebound yet. Griffiths finally comes away with it. Trojans have numbers, 3-on-2. Griffiths running the fast break here. She's going to pull up from the elbow, and she's going to be long. Wibley gets it, and Wibley finishes again. This one getting out of hand here quick, Mr. Up. 34-8.
The student section was saying we want mercy. They might get what they're asking for.
Miller has it out top. She's going to get it to Dyer. Dyer's going to run the pick and roll. She has some room here. Her shot's off, but rebounded by McFadden. McFadden gets it to Rotham. Well, she dumps to Miller. I agree with that call.
Yeah.
Wibley did get the ball, but she got plenty of arm as well. So Wibley fouls Miller, who's going to go to the free throw line to shoot two.
That's only the first foul on Wibley, so we'll take that. We got a minute left here in the first half, but
yeah, really no foul trouble at all. I mean, Dyer just isn't going to get a third before halftime. If she goes to the half with two, she's fine. Miller's first free throw is banked and in. I thought the bank closed at 5 tonight, but it did not. Miller knocks it
home. Not in Evil.
Not in Evil. Miller's going to look to knock this down and finally get the Indians into the double digits. Her second shot is up, and that one's off. Rebounded by Griffiths. And she is going to run the court the opposite way. She has Dybert on the wing, quickly inside to Wenzel. Wenzel kicks to Bingaman. Nice hands there by Jana Strait on the drive by Bingaman. Good job by Strait. That's the kind of thing she does. She keeps her hands active. She plays good defense, good offense. McFadden goes in for the right-hand layup. She's off. Griffiths again going the other way. She has Dybert if she wants her. Dybert was quickly covered. Griffiths did lose control of it, and again corralled by Strait, who's now going the opposite way. She finds McFadden. McFadden's going to drive and kick to Strait. That's a shot she usually makes, and she does. That's same thing. When she gets her feet set, she's not going to miss too often with no defense on her. She makes it 34-12. Trojans will hold for the last shot here with 13 seconds to go. Griffith's going to go one-on-one here with Strait. She's going to spin to her right, get it to Wenzel over for a long two. Wenzel just rims out. And we head to the halftime with the Trojans leading the score 34-12 here over the Indians. Plenty of basketball to play, but certainly a great start for the Trojans. And we will be back for the start of the second half.
Like MI and Milgard, the MI Charitable Foundation stretches from coast to coast. However, when it comes to the foundation, our focus begins at the local level, where we support initiatives in our communities that are closest to the hearts of our team. Though we're quite proud of our endeavors on a national scale, MI's philanthropy started in the communities where we operate, which is why our local outreach committees are integral to the mission of our charitable foundation. We have committees at each of our facilities and throughout our sales organization. These committees take a hands-on approach within their local communities, volunteering, executing events, and fundraising. These teams go above and beyond to ensure we're making a positive impact on the lives of the people who live and work in our communities. These charitable efforts take many different forms. They may involve a charity walk or run, or perhaps a canned food or clothing drive. In some cases, individuals take part in a charitable golf tournament or volunteer to work with children who are fighting serious diseases. Our annual summer concert, Childhood Cancer Paint Night, and Pennsylvania Outreach Golf Outing are three of our largest and most successful local fundraising events. Like all of our outreach initiatives, these events started with a few concerned individuals who wanted to make a difference and support those in need. We like to think of our local charitable efforts as the roots that allow the MI Foundation to grow. The MI Foundation continues to grow bigger and stronger every year because our team members have big hearts, lots of passion, and plenty of enthusiasm. The more the MI Foundation grows, the more people we can extend our support to.
The American Legion was chartered by Congress in 1919 as a patriotic veterans organization. Focusing on service to veterans, service members, and communities, the Legion evolved from a group of war-weary veterans of World War I into one of the most influential nonprofit groups in the United States. It has influenced considerable social change in America, won hundreds of benefits for veterans, and produced many important programs for children and youth. The Trojan Sports Network would like to thank the Elizabethville American Legion Post 404 for their support.
Dairy Queen is located on the main street of Lakens. The inside and outside menus showcase both hot food and plenty of ice cream treats. Dairy Queen is open 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. Sunday through Saturday. Make sure you come and check out all the seasonal blizzards. Remember, it's fan food, not fast food.
Dibler, Straub & Troutman Incorporated is a local insurance company that was founded in 1986 when three separate local insurance companies decided to join forces and become what is now known as Dibler, Straub & Troutman. Being a partner in the Keystone Insurers Group aids them in their goal to provide its clients with a large array of quality choices within the insurance market. Still have questions? You can ask any of the local companies that are insured by Dibler, Straub & Troutman, such as Cuppy's Propane, Dairy Queen, or Halifax Area School District. Head over to their main office, which is located right across the street from Cuppy's on the Square in Elizabethville, or go online to www.dstinsurance.com.
I was drafted number 75. I went to boot camp when I was 20 years old. I'm very thankful for the food bank. And till you go to the grocery store and buy meat or something like that, it doesn't get you very far. And coming here and getting what I get here is the greatest thing in the world. We get everything you could possibly need to survive.
For the best tasting pizza in the valley, come visit JoJo's Pasta and Pizza House. We have something here for everyone, such as
garlic knots, seafood, desserts, and gluten-free options. We're open 7 days a week, and all of our food is made to order. Come dine in at our beautiful dining room. We pride ourselves on our friendly atmosphere. So what are you waiting for? The King awaits you. Visit us at 17 West Main Street in Elizabethville, or call us at 717-362-3064.
Liberty Hose Company number 2 in Lakens is a volunteer fire department that serves Lakens and the surrounding community. Please support your local fire department by visiting our club during one of our upcoming food events. Firehouse offers a variety of burgers, wings, breakfast, pulled pork, brisket, pot pie, and Italian dishes. If you have any questions, visit the fire company's Facebook page for details on upcoming events.
The mission of the Lycans Valley Children's Museum is to provide a safe and interactive environment to inspire children's creativity and love for lifelong learning. Our vision is to create a community where children have access to resources that they need to become creative, curious, innovative, and healthy children who will be ready for the ever-changing world. The museum contains 30 hands-on learning exhibits that are educational and fun for your kids. The exhibit includes STEM, sensory, art stations, and many more. We also provide birthday parties and rental services for your special event. To schedule your event, call us at 570-809-6379. The Lycans Valley Children Museum is located on South Market Street, Elizabethville. To view our hours and learn more information about our museum, visit our website, lvcm.org.
Storage sheds, garages, animal shelters, gazebos, playhouses, and more, Pine Creek Structures has what our customers are looking for. Each of our stores is stocked with a variety of buildings ready to deliver to your backyard. Or you can custom design your perfect building. Choose the colors, move the doors and windows, or add any of the hundreds of options we offer. Stop by your local store and talk to one of our shed experts, or visit us online at pinecreekstructures.com.
Villasiano. Villasiano is located on 4900 State Route 209, Elizabethville, PA. They are open from 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. Come join us for traditional Italian cuisine. Our pizza is made in a beautifully made wooden oven, and finish your meal off with a choice of tiramisu or homemade cannolis. During the summer, our mini golf course is open, so come in and dine in and finish off your evening with a game of mini golf.
Enjoy the Trojan Sports Network? Have you wanted to help the program out with a donation? Well, now you can. The Trojan Sports Network is accepting donations to help fund our program. To donate, please visit www.myschoolbucks.com and create an account. Once you've created your account, you will want to add Upper Dolphin Area School District to your account. Once on the school's page, click Store, then scroll down to TVN Donations. The recommended donations are listed in three levels, gold, silver, and bronze. However, any donations will be accepted. Donors will be acknowledged on future broadcasts. Thanks for supporting our program.
So we are back here for the second half with the Trojan Sports Network. Upper Dolphin leads 34-12. We have a quick stat update from Mr. Rupp.
All right, we'll take a look at the Trojans, who 34 points, led by Maisie Bingaman with 11, Casey Wively with 10, Wenzel has 7, Gracie Griffiths has 4, and Dibert has 2.
Spreading it out, as usual. That's usually what happens.
Five starters, you know, all scoring there. For the Indians, not so much. Strait has 2. McFadden leads all their scorers with 5. And Miller has 4.
Yeah, not a high scoring output so far for the Indians, but they have plenty of time to turn it around.
We want Isaac! We want Isaac!
Got some halftime scores for you. The other girls' semifinal game, number 1, St. Joe's against Susquehanna. St. Joe's leads 30-27 at the half.
Yeah, a close game there like we expected. We knew Susquehanna could play them tough.
And then Halifax all over Juniata down there, and the boys 44-12.
Halifax boys are tough. They're very good. Dyer's going to lose control of the ball there. It's going to be poked away by Maisie Bingaman, so it will stay in the Indians' possession.
Greenwood leads the other boys' semifinal 26-17 over Lime Mountain.
Okay, yeah, I figured a Greenwood-Halifax matchup there was probably how that one would end up. Strait's going to get the ball inside to Miller. Nice pass. She's going to drop step to the left side, and she gets it in off the glass. Millersburg, I mean, that should be their look every possession. She should touch the ball as often as possible. She can shoot or she can pass out of it.
I like I said, I'm no basketball expert, but yes.
Get her some touches.
Absolutely.
Shouldn't be too hard to figure that one out. Wenzel's going to look to go there, but she's going to have the ball knocked away by McFadden, but it was off of Wenzel, so it will be Millersburg ball. I mean, that's what they're going to need. They're going to need to get good shots and get plenty of stops. 40 seconds into the half, they're off to a good start. The clock has not started yet. There we go. Straight's going to look inside to Rothermel. She's going to knock it into Miller, but Wibley pokes it away. Good defense there by Casey Wibley.
Good hands there.
And that's what all the Trojans, they all have active hands. They're just contesting the passing lanes as much as possible tonight. Straight looking for someone. She can't find anybody. She tries to get to Dyer. Might have went off the back of Emily Dybert's head. But regardless, it's controlled by Fallon McFadden. This is not where Miller should have the ball. She should have it in the paint, not outside the three-point line. Millersburg are going to keep running through their offense. Rothermel finds McFadden. She's going to rip and go right. Tries to find Miller, who couldn't corral it. It's off of Miller and back to the Trojans.
Another turnover there. So.
Yeah. We don't have a turnover count, but we're well past. We're onto our toes for sure for Millersburg. We might be through all of our fingers and toes. It has been a lot.
We might need to soon use Jordan's toes back there.
Couple extra feet and hands here. Dyberg going to do a little dribble handoff to Bingaman. She's going to look to go right, but Millersburg all over it. She hands it off to Griffiths, who's going to split the two defenders and go up for the layup. She is fouled hard by Miller. And we'll have two free throws coming up for Gracie Griffiths.
So you were at the St. Joe's Upper Dolphin game. Trojans got a huge lead in that game, and it kind of...
I mean, the lights were barely still on in the gym after Upper Dolphin almost shot them out. It was crazy, and then they just slowly unraveled. I mean, it wasn't even really an unraveling. It was more just St. Joe's finally
grinding
picked
it out.
That's just how they are. They're just a tough team. Griffith's second free throw is no good. Wildly tries to follow it up. I thought she might have been fouled, but it is going to be out of bounds and Indians ball. Yeah, St. Joe's, I mean, their number, I forget what number she was. Naomi Crispin is her name. She's only a sophomore, leading scorer in the league by a long shot. She's just incredible. I mean, they have multiple. I think they have four girls in the top 10 maybe in scoring. It's, whatever it is, it's a lot. They're just a good all-around team. Well-coached. They're very impressive. Dyer pulls the three. Hers is short. She was able to get her own rebound, and she's going to be fouled by Dybert, so it will remain with the Indians.
Yeah, as you mentioned, St. Joe's has two of the top three scorers in the league, four in the top 15.
That's what I thought. Four of their five starters are just incredible. But as we have said, they have been pushed by Millersburg, Susquehanna, and Upper Dolphin, so they are not invincible. They just haven't lost yet in the league. Straight's going to drive baseline, look to dump it off, but never had a chance. Miller fights for it, but eventually Wenzel gets it. Again, that help defense by the Trojans. Straight just had nowhere to go with it. There was three girls totally around her. So we're going the other way, and Dybert's going to look inside. She's going to find Wibley. Wibley's going to try to rip back and go to her right, but good defense there by Miller. Eventually poked away by Bingaman for Millersburg ball.
I like the idea there by Wibley. Yeah. She just couldn't keep her balance and stay on her feet.
Yeah, she almost had it. I think maybe one too many dribbles. She just kind of got a little clustered and turned it over. Going back the other way, McFadden has Rothermel, who's going to give it back to Straight. She's going to shoot three. She's going to be blocked by Emily Dybert. And it will be corralled by Wibley. Good job by Dyber. She came flying like she was shot out of a cannon there to block that ball.
And did a nice job not to make contact.
Yeah, good defense. Bingaman is going to take the screen from Wenzel and go right, but poked away by McFadden momentarily. Bingaman eventually finds Dyber. She kicks to Griffiths. Her three's up, and it's just off the side rim. So Dyer grabs it, and we're headed back the other way. Only 3 points scored so far in 3 minutes here in this half.
Yeah, a little slow start here, both teams.
Millersburg has picked it up on defense, which is good, but they need to get it going on offense as well. McFadden goes for the layup there, but she can't knock it home.
I feel like Miller got away with one there.
Wenzel grabs the rebound. She's going the other way. She gets around Rothermel. Her layup is up, and it's good. And the Trojans extend their lead back to 23 points. Straight might pull a three here. Nope, she doesn't. She likes to pass it to Rothermel. She has it poked away. It's a fight for the ball. And eventually we get a travel on Rothermel. She kind of rolled over with the ball there, so that's the travel. And it is Trojan's ball, and we have Jordan Miller checking back in for Maisie Bingaman. And we're going to have Belier checking in again, presumably for Rothermel. And that is the case. It's kind of an odd matchup with Trojans. They have three big girls out there, and Millersburg only has one big girl on the court, so Wibley and Wenzel have to cover a guard. But they'll make it work. They've been making it work all night. Certainly not going to say that their defense needs adjusted. Driver tries to get it to Wibley. She eventually does. Wentzel's going to get it over in the corner. Good defense there by Janus. Straight to knock away the pass, and Wentzel commits a foul. And that's the only thing that Reagan Wentzel will continue to improve on. She sometimes commits fouls in areas where she should just get back on defense.
Yeah, sometimes when she misses a play, yeah, she feels that she,
yeah,
she makes
a frustration foul. Yep. And that's one, again, she's a sophomore. That's one you learn as you keep playing. But no harm done there. That's only her first foul tonight, so no foul trouble concerns at all. Belier has the ball in the wing. She's going to dump it off to McFadden. She has a layup. She passes it to Miller. Instead, good pass by McFadden and a good finish for Emma Miller. Again, the more she touches the ball tonight, as long as she can corral the pass, the better off Northwood has been. Wentzel with a very nice screen on the Dyer. Diver gets around her. Diver's going to try to get it to Wibley. It's kind of poked around, but Wibley gets it, and eventually it's poked away and secured by Miller. Miller's going to try to run the court, but she's going to pull it out. Get the straight, and we have an injury of some sort. McFadden, maybe a bloody nose, bloody lip. If there's blood involved, she has to come out. It looks like Coach Huffman's going to take a 30-second timeout here, so we're going to stay here. Obviously, we'll need to see what's going on with McFadden. I don't know if she got hit in the mouth.
Yeah, I don't see either. It's a little behind the play.
Yeah, I was wondering why they stopped the play, and then I saw. Which, if she's bleeding, she'll have to come out, but if she's not bleeding, she'll be okay.
21-point lead here.
Yeah, I mean, not really a great start to the half for the Trojans, but when you build yourself that big of a cushion in the first half, you have a little bit more leeway than usual.
So I did have a couple people checking in with us as they listened to us. Well, we enjoy them listening.
Absolutely.
But the Crispin girl from St. Joe's, we failed to mention her father,
Joe Crispin,
played at Penn State University.
Didn't just play there. He was their number 4 all-time leading scorer.
Okay, there you go.
And he's now an assistant coach there. So.
And head coach up there is Bethany Irwine. She played at PSU as well.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
And I'm pretty sure that her daughter played for UConn.
At Connecticut. I heard that as well. Yeah. Nice job there by Strait. She dumps it off to Rothamel for the layup. Yeah, and I believe her husband coaches St. Joe's JV team, and they run a really nice program. I was very impressed with them. Dibert's going to go all the way to the basket here maybe for a little right-hand reverse layup, and she's up and good with a little scoop shot there. Good job by Dibert to extend the lead right back to 21. Quick answer for the Trojans. Dyer has Rothamel here. She's going to try to get it to her. Wentzel's going to knock it away. Straight is looking for Miller, but just didn't have a passing lane. Now she does get it to Miller, but that's not where you want Miller to have the ball. You want her on the block if possible. Valier's going to swing it over to Rothamel. She's going to try to run. Oh, nice backdoor cut by Janus Straight, but a nice block by Casey Wibley to make up for it. Just a physical game tonight. Very good job all around. This time Strait's going to be fouled. She'll get the call this time. That one's going to be on Wentzel. That will be Wentzel's second. So Strait will go to the line to shoot two.
Yeah, we thank Jill Steffen checking in from Millersburg. And I thought that was right. They put it wrong up there last. That's the third foul on Wentzel.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I just read the board when I saw it. She had one, it said. So, yeah, she'll probably come out here. It looks like Ella Griffiths and Maisie Bigman are set to check in. I'm sure one's for Wentzel. I guess one's maybe for Miller or Dibert would be my guess.
So the Irwin's daughter actually coaches at Vanderbilt.
Oh, look at that.
Some information there. We appreciate that. Mrs. Steffen down there in Millersburg checking out Trojan Sports Network this evening.
Division I basketball running through the veins of the whole program by the sounds of it. Makes sense why they're so talented and well-coached. McFadden's right back in for Rothamel for Millersburg.
I'm pretty sure as well that Irwine was a state college head coach for quite a few years.
I did hear
well.
That as well. Yeah, you could tell she has those players.
So she's familiar with that area up there.
Yeah, definitely. Dibert's getting covered hard here by Dyer. Good defense by Dyer. Dibert finds Griffiths, who's going to get a screen from Wibley. Another screen from Wibley. She had Wibley there for a second but didn't find her, and she travels with it before. Yeah, that was a travel. Her dad's not happy about it, but it was. That pivot foot moved a little bit.
Tell you what, we put a little Hawaiian hat on Coach Huffman, he might fit right in the student section.
I always
over
find
there.
It funny how he sits on the bench with the students. He's just a funny guy.
He loves his Phillies.
Absolutely. And his Steelers. Dyer's going to kick it out to Valier here. Bigman with a tight defense on Valier. Valier tried to get it to Janus Straight. Eventually it was saved by McFadden.
Great hustle by McFadden.
Yeah, that was good. It really, the pass wasn't even meant for her, but she ran it down, saved it. Eventually Miller was fouled by Wibley.
And You know, we mentioned a lot of these names that we're saying here in a few weeks you're going to be saying on the softball field.
Yeah,
you know, a lot of talented softball players out there in the court right now, too.
District champions last year.
Yep.
And they returned most of their players, as far as I remember. I could be forgetting, but they're going to be a good team this year, no doubt. Straight has the ball in the corner. She thought about a three. She's going to try to go baseline. She kicks it to Valier. Valier's going to put it along, too, and that's just off the back rim. But it is ran down by Dyer. She's going to try to get it to Miller, but too high on the pass. And it's going the other way.
Indians, just every time, they look like they're starting to get things going.
Yeah, I mean, it's a 19-point game, which doesn't take that long to get it down to 10 from there. But instead, you know, I thought Wibley was going to extend it back to 21. But she doesn't get it. And we have Trojans ball.
Straight got hit in the nose, and she stood up to help herself. And the ball went out of bounds, and the Trojans are going to get possession.
Thought maybe she'd get a foul call, which obviously the refs just didn't see that. If Straight's bleeding, she'll have to come out. Looks like she is bleeding. She's showing the ref that she has blood on her finger.
Hard to believe that with three officials out there, they'd
right, yeah,
hasn't
not somebody. It was right where the ball was. You
definitely
think
was a lot of contact, that's for sure.
Millersburg has a valid complaint about that one going uncalled. Anyway, Griffiths is going to shoot a long three. That looks up, and it is good. Nothing but net. That one was pure by Gracie Griffiths, and then Trojans lead is back up to 22. We quickly have Dyer coming the other way. She goes for a layup. She can't get it. We have a total mosh pit for the ball, and it is a jump ball.
McFadden in there again with a hustle play.
Yeah, good job. She's been involved in quite a few jump balls tonight as well. We have Trojans ball. Millersburg trying some kind of a press here. We'll see if it's just a man-to-man press. Griffiths is going to dribble right around Miller. Dyer's going to come in and help. Griffiths is going to find Dibert on the wing. Dibert maybe was fouled, but that one went uncalled, and Rothenwell stole it. Griffiths stole it back. We're all over the place out here, but eventually Dibert puts up the layup and gets it to fall.
Trojans just never giving up there and scrambling for the ball.
We've seen with Millersburg tonight, when they get a lot of sorts, it usually ends poorly for them. With the Trojans, it still seems to end well so far tonight. Miller's going to drop step to her left, put it up with her right, but she's going to miss it, and it will be rebounded by Gracie Griffiths. Yeah, sometimes the bounces just go your way, and sometimes they don't. And Upper Dolphin has certainly gotten some better bounces tonight. Griffiths going to go right around Miller here. She's going to try to put up a layup, but travel with it. Mr. Huffman is frustrated about something. We have a timeout.
I found it interesting, Connor, that Miller would be covering Griffiths out top like that.
Yeah, I mean, if that's the matchup, just leave Miller, get her like when she gets to the three-point line. Miller, that's really not her specialty, full-court defense.
Right.
So, yeah, I mean, that's, again, with Straight going out, you see that just makes the matchups an absolute nightmare.
Are at Susquehanna on Wednesday. We will not be broadcasting, but the NFHS Network will broadcast those games.
Do we know who's first, boys or girls?
Yeah, I did know that.
But you don't remember it?
I'm kind of supposed to know that, I guess, but I forget which is which.
And not that it matters.
I do believe the boys are second this
boys,
year.
Okay. I know it switches every year.
The girls are first, so that'll be the six and eight, basically, for the start times.
Straight is back into the game, so if she had a nosebleed, it is now fixed. She's going to dribble around Wibley and put the layup up, but it's off. Miller tries to get the rebound, but she can't grab it again. I feel like that's been the story of the night. Somebody can't grab it for Millersburg. It just hasn't been their night. We keep saying it, but that's how it's been. Bingaman inbounds to Ella Griffiths. Eventually gets the ball back to Bingaman. Trojans going to save for the last shot here would be my guess.
I'll be really anxious, Connor, to see if Reagan Hale's back for playoffs.
That would be huge for them because they're a good team. Don't let tonight's score fool you. And losing Hale really has hurt them. If she's back, they are right back in the thick of things. Straight ends up coming away with a steal from Griffiths there. She's going to get the layup to go up and good. 44-22. And unless Dibert's three-quarter court heave is good, which it is not, we are going to end the third quarter with the Trojans leading the Indians 44-22. We're going to run some commercials, and we'll be back on the Trojan Sports Network.
Like MI and Milgard, the MI Charitable Foundation stretches from coast to coast. However, when it comes to the foundation, our focus begins at the local level, where we support initiatives in our communities that are closest to the hearts of our team. Though we're quite proud of our endeavors on a national scale, MI's philanthropy started in the communities where we operate, which is why our local outreach committees are integral to the mission of our charitable foundation. We have outreach committees at each of our facilities and throughout our sales organization. These committees take a hands-on approach within their local communities, volunteering, executing events, and fundraising. These teams go above and beyond to ensure we're making a positive impact on the lives of the people who live and work in our communities. These charitable efforts take many different forms. They may involve a charity walk or run.
All right, we are back for the start of the fourth quarter here. We have a score update from St. Joe's versus Susquehanna. St. Joe's leads 44-35 after the third quarter in that one.
So if you're Millersburg here, Connor, what do you, I mean, such a deficit here, what are you doing? You know, you got District 3 playoffs starting in another week. What are you trying to tell your girls here?
I mean, hopefully they just get something going, get a little confidence built back up. Obviously, you hope no one gets hurt. That'd be a big one. They're probably not going to come back and win this game. I don't think I'm speaking too soon. Miller commits a foul there on Wenzel. We have Valier set the check back in. I wonder why she didn't just start the quarter if she's checking in 30 seconds into the quarter. But, yeah, I think the big thing for Millersburg is just get some confidence back, maybe find the bottom of the bucket a couple of times here.
And you got to think with straight the athlete that she is, that she could really have an impact in that double-A level.
Absolutely, yeah. And like you said, with the size, too, the combination of her and Miller at the double-A District 3 tournament, that should be huge for them. But if they don't have Hale, I mean, they are the number one seed, but they are no shoe-in to win that district, especially if Hale's not back.
Correct.
Even if Hale's there, though, some of those teams are going to put up a fight. Straight going to knock that pass away, and it's eventually secured by Fallon McFadden. We have Straight going the other way with it. She's going to look to push the court hard. She's going to take it in for a layup. Hers is off, and it's rebounded by Dibert. Straight picking Dibert up with the full court defense. Good ball handling there by Dibert to avoid the pressure from Straight. Bingham is going to rip to go around Dyer, but good defense from Dyer. A good help defense from Dyer as well. Wibley eventually finds Wenzel, who kicks it back to Bingham. Bingham just can't get around Dyer. Oh, I don't even know if that was a foul either. That was just...
Yeah, I don't like that one either, but I tell you what, Dyer's like a gnat.
Yeah, she just
don't go away.
She's relentless.
Oh my goodness.
Every time someone tries to rip around her and go baseline, they can't. They just run out of room. She's awesome to watch play. Dibert gets the ball now, again defended by Dyer. Dibert's going to find Wibley inside. Her layup is just off and secured by Emma Miller. Straight looking to push the court the other way. Dyer gets it into Miller. Miller drop steps right, and she just can't find the bottom. Eventually, McFadden misses, and Miller finally finishes it. That's the story of Millersburg tonight. That ball was at least halfway down. That just rolled out.
In and out.
They cut the lead down to 20. We have 6.5 minutes to go here in this one. Wenzel going to set a screen for Dibert at the top. Dibert's going to go all the way to the basket for a right-handed layup, and that's just off. Wenzel fights for the rebound and pulls it down. She finds Miller, whose pass is stolen by Straight. Good defense there by Jana Straight. She kept her eyes up. She kept her eye on that the whole way. Takes it for a layup. Again, as the Trojans, I mean, you have a big enough lead here where you just take it easy, play it smart, and you're good, but you don't want to fall apart here.
Right.
Stay firing on all cylinders. Carry that momentum right over into Wednesday night. Wibley gets stuck in the corner, but she finds Wenzel. Wenzel's going to look to rip and go around Miller, and she gets around with ease. There's that athleticism on display by Regan Wenzel. She went right around Miller. She finds the easy layup. Dyer's coming back the other way with a quick layup. She can't get the fall, and Wenzel again grabs the rebound. She runs right around McFadden.
She's feeling it.
But she might get caught from behind here. Nope, she somehow still has the ball. Good job by Wenzel. Wibley kicks to Bingham, who's just going to take it easy. No crazy passes. Miller's going to pull up for three, and it's good. Jordan Miller with her first points of the evening pushes the lead back to 23 for the Trojans. That's Miller's game right there. She's a three-point shooter.
Absolutely. And I tell you what a backbreaker that's going to be for Miller. You're like getting a little bit of momentum, clawing your way back in a little bit, and then
right back to a 23-point
comes off the bench and just drains one.
Yep, we are, again, 23-point deficit for the Indians. 5 minutes to go. Miller's going to look to go baseline. She's going to try to dump it to Wibley, but it is turned over. Wibley stays after it, though, but it is eventually secured by Olivia Dyer.
Another third-quarter score, Greenwood 39. lined out in 32, so that one's kind of staying close.
We had Dyer's layup there blocked by Wenzel, so it will stay with the Indians. We do have a 60-second timeout by Millersburg, so we're going to run a commercial here, and we'll be right back on the Trojan Sports Network. All right, we are back here on the Trojan Broadcast Network.
We got virtual day tomorrow,
yeah,
Connor.
You
never had one of those. You know, that was before your time.
No day. Now,
yeah.
I mean, my work days are almost all virtual these days anyway, so no big deal for me if it's a virtual day.
It's old Jordy Pfeiffer back there. He's going to get a virtual day. do you still have to go to co-op, though, and work? Oh,
Valier's three is up, and that's off. Miller with the rebound. She's blocked by Wenzel. Eventually secured by Ella Griffiths. Do we think Pfeiffer's waking up on time tomorrow with the virtual day?
He's an early bird, I think.
Okay, that's good.
He's been in lately, lifting in the morning, that's a tough foul.
Griffiths going to foul straight there on the layup. I don't know. The crowd's mad. That's just a hard foul on a layup. You're not going to eject someone for committing a foul on a layup.
But if you're Gracie, you got to be careful.
Yeah.
You get a flagrant.
I mean,
you have to sit out the next game, and
right.
That's not going to be a...
I mean, you could tell. Griffiths definitely put some frustration into that foul, but it's nothing to warrant a technical or anything, in my opinion. But straight is down. That's the one thing. There's not much room between the baseline and the wall.
Yeah.
So people smack that padding pretty hard sometimes.
Maybe we need a bigger gym.
Yeah, that wouldn't hurt. I don't know where we would extend it, but...
No, we can go out that way.
See what Mr. Bell has to say about that.
Yeah, we can go out that. We can knock that wall out. You know, extend that wall out, going to the courtyard. We could do something pretty fanatical here, but, I mean, we would need some pretty good engineers.
Right. I'm certainly not that guy. I think we're going to step away here. We're going to run a commercial. We'll see what's up with straight when we get back.
Villasiano. Villasiano is located on 4900 State Route 209, Elizabethville, PA. They are open from 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. Come join us for traditional Italian cuisine. Our pizza is made in a beautifully made wooden oven and finish your meal off with a choice of tiramisu or homemade cannolis. During the summer, our mini golf course is open, so come in and dine in and finish off your evening with a game of mini golf.
Okay, we are back here, and it looks like Davia, the trainer, is working on the elbow of Jana Strait.
Yeah, that's a concern for the Indians, not just for district basketball playoffs, but also a concern for the Trojans' softball season.
And, of course, you just hope she's okay no matter what happens there.
Right.
Rothermull checks in for Strait, so she shoots the free throws. The first one was off, left it a little short. Her second free throw is up. And that one's good. 49-27 here, the Trojans lead. 4 minutes and 20 seconds to go in this contest. Wenzel sets a nice hard screen for Dibert. But Dyer, as like you said, she's staying in there.
She's not giving an inch.
Wenzel just going to take her time. And eventually Miller's going to come out and pick her up. And then Wenzel finds Miller. Trojans are just going to showcase patience here. There's no reason to rush anything right now.
Got Ella Griffiths in the game there.
She finds Wenzel, who brings it back to Dibert. And again, until you have a good shot, you don't have to take a shot. And that was not a good pass by Dibert. Miller's going to get that one. She's going to look to back down Dibert. Somehow ends up getting the pass back. I don't even know. She passed her off and it got punched right back to her. And Miller eventually finishes it.
How much longer until you see Coach Huffman maybe empty the bench here?
Yeah, I mean, with Millersburg, they're going to keep their starters in, so you don't want to do it too early. I'd say, once we get the 2 minutes, get them in there. Don't get anybody hurt before Wednesday.
Oh.
Wenzel's layup was off there, grabbed by Miller.
She's been able to go around Miller all night.
Right, yeah. Again, that's not – Miller can defend the paint. She's not going to defend the three-point line. That's not her specialty. Miller's going to pass to McFadden, whose layup is off and secured by Griffiths on the rebound. Gracie Griffiths looking to go the other way. McFadden's going to poke it out from behind, though. It will stay Upper Dolphin ball. Jordan Miller gets the inbound here and picked up by Valier. Miller's going to kick it over to Dibert. And like we said, Chardon is just going to remain patient here.
The student section trying to get influence Sam Coach there. Huffman over there.
If we see her, it's not going to be yet. But I think he'll put – yeah, Miller's going to send a sub up there. So we're going to see subs here sooner than later. Miller, Upper Dolphin right now just playing keep away. Wenzel eventually going to go around Miller, hit a little Euro step. Her layup is just off. She gets her own rebound, passes to Ella Griffiths, who knocks it home. Her first points of the night make it a 51-29 ball game. Dyer coming back the other way in a hurry. She takes it up over Dibert, but couldn't get the fall. Miller gathers the rebound, and her layup does fall. So Miller's quietly racking up some points here, just getting these putbacks. We have a full timeout for Millersburg, so we're going to run a quick commercial break, and we will be right back.
Common Chevrolet Buick GMC is one of Central Pennsylvania's oldest dealerships, offering all of our customers the highest level of excellence. Family owned and operated since 1913, at Troutman's we go the extra mile to make sure you leave our showroom completely satisfied. Whether you're looking for a new, pre-owned, or used vehicle, our sales specialists provide a hassle-free, relaxed, and comfortable environment. Stop by our showroom in Millersburg and let us meet all your Buick, Chevrolet, and GMC automotive needs.
We are back here. We have some score updates. So we have St. Joe's leading Susquehanna girls by, did you say, 6?
Yep, St. Joe's is up by 6 with 2:30 left, and Greenwood only leads Lime Mountain by 3 with 4 minutes left in the boys' side. Halifax did end up winning that one down there as they 69-34. They cruised to
Juniata.
Yeah, over Juniata.
Lime Mountain not going down without a fight there against Greenwood, though.
No.
I would strongly expect to see at least a couple subs here entered for the Trojans. Millersburg has 3 non-starters in. Just don't want to get anybody else hurt. Of course, again, we hope Jana Strait's okay over there.
Right.
Griffith's going to get the ball in the high post. She might look to take the jump shot. She does pass it up, though. Smart play. Just keep passing it around. She's going to shoot it this time, though. That shot's off the back rim and no good. Minute 30 to go. Dyer's coming the other way. She's going to pull it out. Coach Huffman does have some subs going to the line now here. Griffiths is going to secure the loose ball there after a little fight for it. She's coming the other way.
And it looks like they're making wholesale. All 5 subs coming in next for the Trojans.
Yep. It looks like Mr. Huffman just wants the timeout to get the subs in the game. But,
yep.
I mean, if Coach Everhart wants the timeout, he can take it if he wants it.
Doesn't like either team's taking it.
No, I think they just want to get this over with. Hope nobody else gets hurt. So Upper Dolphin has a whole new 5. We have Olivia Conrad, Paige Williams, Meadow Mosser, Kate Rothamel, and Ella Griffith still in there. So I would assume here in about 20 seconds, Sam Cran. Yep, she's
there
checking in now.
She's
going to replace Griffiths. Mosser with the ball, kicks it over to Williams. I apologize for not knowing some of the Millersburg girls' names here. Upper Dolphin just keeping the ball away, passing it around, playing it safe. Going to need a dead ball here at some point. Ella Griffiths takes one for the team and throws it out of bounds. Allow Sam Cran to check into the
and
game.
And the student section loves it.
Good team play there by Griffiths. You take a turnover on your stats, but you get your teammate in. You'll take that every day.
Absolutely. That's great. And a little bit concerning, Connor, is straight still kind of
got ice.
Not good over there with the elbow.
Yeah, got ice on her elbow. Looked like Paige Williams gets a rebound here. She's looking to run the other way. She's going to go up for the layup, but it's going to go. It's going to be poked away. Yeah, I mean, you were talking about softball. At least it's her left elbow. But obviously,
yep,
for basketball purposes, you need both of them. So hopefully she'll be back out there for their district games. Meadow and Moss are going to inbound the ball. She's going to find Crane in the wing. Almost knocks it home just off the back rim. Dyer's going to come the other way.
This place would have erupted.
Yeah, it almost, you almost did. You started your eruption.
I thought she had it.
It looked good. We have a foul there by Olivia Conrad, so it's going to be Millersburg ball down underneath with 20 seconds to go.
So Trojans are going to advance here to the championship game.
For at least the second year in a row, maybe more, I don't know.
It is the second year in a row. They're looking to make it two in a row.
Yep, they did win it last year against Millersburg over there at Newport. Millersburg just can't get a shot to fall right now. We have Upper Dolphin ball with 6 seconds left. We might get to see one more attempt here from Sam Cran.
Maybe.
They might just take it out, though. We'll see. Looks like they're not in a hurry. Williams going to get stuck with it. And the time's going to run out on this one. So Upper Dolphin will advance to take on either St. Joe's or Sesamito on Wednesday night. They take this game 51-31. We thank you all for tuning into the Trojan Sports Network, and we will see you next time. And wait, actually, don't go off yet. Thank you, Mr. Up, for
thank
the broadcast.
You for, we appreciate him, and thank you, Jordan Pfeiffer, for helping us out.
Did
tonight.
Not want to leave without thanking Jordan for being over here and helping us. So now we'll call it again. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you on the next one.